Okay, thank you for being here. I'm Hitoshi Murayama. So this is a special week for our friends here working on a big experiment called CMS experiment.
这个这一周是一个很特别的一周，尤其是对我们这边这个CMS的同仁们的一个 CMS week 的一个活动。
And many leaders of this experiment are actually here.
这个实验的领导人都在这边。
More than 2,000 people from around the world are working together for this experiment. Am I right?
That's right. 有超过两千人以上的科学家在这样一个实验团队里面工作。
And one of the really big things they have done so far is to discover this particle, God particle.
到目前为止，做的最重要的一个贡献呢，就是发现了这个粒子，神之粒子。
So that is what I would like to talk about today.
这就是我今天要讲的一部分。
And the English title, of course, was something like that.
这就是英文的标题，就是长得这个样子。
So many of you may not be familiar what physicists do.
也许很多各位这边并不知道物理学家是做了些什么。
And what we do is actually something very, very simple.
事实上我们做的事是非常非常的简单。
We ask very simple questions about the universe.
我们问很简单而且深刻的问题关于这个宇宙。
Just like when you were a small child looking up the sky and wondered, how did the universe begin?
就像你在小时候你看着这个天空，然后开始思考说，这个宇宙是怎么样的开始？
What is its fate?
那它的命运会怎么样？
What is made of?
它是怎么样子做成的？
What are its fundamental laws?
那是哪些所谓的基本的作用力？
Where do we come from?
那我们到底怎么来的？
And many of the things I will talk about today has to do with the last question, where we come from.
今天要讨论的主要问题就是最后一个问题，我们怎么来的？
Of course, human beings have been asking this question for many thousands of years.
当人类已经问了这个问题，有几千年的历史了。
In part of religions,
从这个宗教
philosophy,
哲学
and recently we can talk about evolutionary biology that we came from apes.
甚至包括这个演化的一个过程。
And I'm not sure we're evolving in the right way these days.
而且我并不确定我们是走向正确的一个方向。
But what we would like to understand is where we came from. So the kind of tool we really need is the time machine.
我们真的需要的东西是一个时光机器。
And you may be surprised to hear that we do have time machines.
也许你会感到惊讶，事实上我们真的有时光机器。
There are big telescopes like that one, and something called particle accelerator.
我们有一个所谓有像这样的一个望远镜的装备，像左边那样，以及所谓的像我们的加速器，像右边这样的东西。
And using these big telescopes, you can actually look very far away. But it takes so many years for light to reach us. You are looking at the universe of the past.
如果使用望远镜，你可以看得非常的远。那因为光要透过很久的时间才会到达我们，所以我们可以看到很久的过去。
For example, if you take a picture of Andromeda Galaxy, you are looking at how it was like 2.3 million years ago.
如果你照一张这个仙女座星云的照片，那这个是比如说230万年前的光，看到的是这个样子。
If somebody in Andromeda can look at the Earth, they see us like being monkeys.
如果那边有人的话，看到我们就像是猴子。
If you look farther away, you see these beautiful cluster of galaxies. This one is 2.1 billion years ago.
如果你看得更远的话，这个是一个银河的重击，那它基本上是20亿光年那么远。
And the farthest ever galaxy people have seen is this one, which is at 13.3 billion light years away.
Okay, 如果你再看得更远一点的话，你会看到像这样的一个银河，它是133亿光年这么远。
if you zoom up this image, this is still too dark to see, but in the end you find this little red smudge. That is a galaxy.
OK, 如果你看左边的图不是很清楚，然后你把它放大，然后再放大，再放大，有时候看到一个类似的点，那个就是这一个银河。
And you are looking at the universe that way it was 13.3 billion years ago.
那你看的就是这个银河是一个133亿年前的一个银河。
And if you look really, really far away, then you can see the way universe was born.
如果你看的可以看到这么久，再看更远的话，你几乎可以看到这个银河是怎么样被诞生的。
So you can still see the Big Bang happening right now.
所以你还是可以看到我们的所谓的宇宙大爆炸，即使在现在。
This is the picture of the baby universe, the way it was 13.8 billion years ago.
这是我们所谓的宇宙诞生之初的小朋友宇宙，或是婴儿宇宙的一个照片，它是138亿年前的一个照片。
But it turns out, even this one is not the very beginning of the universe.
即使是这样，这并不是真正宇宙的开始的开始。
So ideally, you would like to see beyond this to really see how the universe was when it really began.
那我们希望能够跟真的穿过这样的一个限制，然后让我们知道宇宙真正的开始是长什么样子。
But there is a sad news.
但是这边有一个不好的新闻。
You can never see beyond this wall using any telescopes.
你使用任何的望远镜都没办法看穿这一道墙。
That's because back then, universe was so hot and dense, even light cannot go through it.
因为在那个时候呢，这宇宙是这么样的热，这么样的的密集，连光都没办法打穿它。
Whole universe was made of these small particles called electrons and protons. It was so dense and hot, light cannot go through it. So this is the limit we can ever see with a telescope.
这宇宙是那时候只用像是质子以及电子这些的东西的组合，那它是非常密度非常高，即使光都没办法穿过这样的一道墙。
But to understand where we came from, we really would like to see how the universe began.
但是为了要能够知道我们应该为了能够知道宇宙怎么诞生，我们一定要能够超过这个样的限制。
The picture of the Big Bang I have shown goes back to this point when the universe was only 380,000 years old.
我们的这个望远镜最后能看到只有到这个38万年的等级。
Compared to the age of universe today, that is 13.8 billion years.This is like just a baby universe. If the whole age of universe is 1 year, this is only like 15 minutes.
如果跟现在宇宙年龄138亿年前的来比的话，这个是一个非常短的时间。如果算成人生的话，只不过是15分钟左右而已。
But if this is the beginning of the universe we can ever see with a telescope, how do we understand what happened earlier on?So if this is the limit of the universe you can ever see with a telescope, how do we understand what happened earlier on?
如果这是我们最早宇宙能够看到的部分，那我们要能够看穿它，才能知道宇宙更早的一个发展的一个情形。
For this purpose, we use the machine called accelerators.
为了达到这个目标，我们建立所谓的加速器。
Using accelerators, we can study what kind of things were going on in early universe by smashing particles with an incredible energy that existed back at the time of the Big Bang.
使用这个加速器呢，我们可以把粒子非常高的能量对撞呢，让我们更接近这个宇宙的诞生的一个情形。
For example, we think we know what the universe was like when it was only 3 minutes old.
比如说，如果我们希望能够看到宇宙刚诞生的3分钟左右的一个情形
，using accelerators, you can smash particles called neutrons and protons together and build up an atom called helium.
可以使用这样的机器呢去对撞一个对撞质子呢以及中子呢，最后产生像是氦核的东西。
Because this is what we can do in the laboratory using accelerators, we are quite sure that this happened also at the beginning of the universe.
因为我们这个是我们在实验中实验室里面能够做出来的一个环境，那我们相信同样的反应呢，在宇宙诞生之初呢，也会有类似的反应。
Using information we learn from accelerators, we can predict that about a quarter of the atoms in the universe have become helium.
使用这样的一个实验呢，我们知道在宇宙诞生之初呢，大概有四分之一 的这个质子呢，最后变成了这氦核。
So the ratio of hydrogen to helium should be about 3-1, and this in turn actually agrees with what we can see and measure with telescopes.
在实验室里面，我们可以这样子去预期呢，这个氢与氦的比例呢是3:1，那这跟我们的观测呢是符合的。
That's why we are quite sure that we understand the universe when it was only 3 minutes old.
这就是为什么我们认为在我们到目前为止是很了解宇宙诞生三分钟左右的世界。
But now comes a very important question.
那如果现在来到一个更重要的一个问题
，If the Big Bang made only helium but no carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, iron, how could you be born?We need those elements.
如果这个宇宙只有这个氢与氦，而没有更重的东西，像是碳，像是氧，像是氮气，甚至像是铁，我们怎么有办法生存在这个地方呢
？That question we could answer.
这个问题我们有办法回答。
Even though the universe started out only with hydrogen and helium.That eventually became a star. Inside a star, you can bring more helium atoms together to build up bigger atoms like carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, helium. The iron and so on.
所以如果我们就算一开始只有氢与氦，那在整个宇宙里面，这渐渐的会聚集，然后使得产生这个更多的更重的东西，像是氧以及氮以及碳以及铁。
But if those chemical elements are all inside a star, you can still not be born because you cannot use them.
即使你有这些更重的元素呢，你也没有办法被生出来，因为你没办法使用它们。
Somehow you need to take those elements out from the star.
你需要有种方法把这些东西从这个星星里面抽出来。
But luckily, some of these big stars at the end of their life actually explode and releases all these elements into outer space.
所以在某些情形的时候，这些星星最后会爆炸，然后并且把这些这些重的元素呢送到我们的世界，变成我们的一部分。
That's how you could be born.
这就是你为什么被诞生的一个缘故。
This is actually my daughter on a day when she was not happy.
这其实是我女儿，她那一天她不太开心。
But as you see, we are literally stardust.
所以基本上我们其实是星星之子。
So this answers part of the question where we came from.
这就是回答我们问题，我们从哪里来的一个基本的问题。
But this is not a full story.
这当然不是全部的故事喽。
We are all made of atoms, but the atoms not only have these nuclei that have been born inside the stars, we also need these electrons moving around the nucleus.
我们虽然是原子构成，但是原子里面有原子核，然后我们还有电子在外面环绕。
What made this possible is the subject of my talk today, namely the Higgs boson or God particle.
那要造成这件事情呢，就是我今天要讨论的主题，也就是所谓的希格斯玻色子，也就是神质粒子。
And the discovery of the Higgs boson became a big news worldwide.
当这个发现希格斯玻色子这件事情呢，是一个世界级的超级大新闻。
And this was done by our friends here working at the LHC accelerator.
这件事情就是被我们在这里，在我的在这里工作的伙伴朋友，在这个 LGC 这个加速器所做下的实验。
This accelerator is inside this long tunnel that has a circumference of 27 kilometers. Very big.
Yeah. 这个加速器呢，就是待在这个27公里的环状的内部呢，它是一个非常非常大的加速器。
This is actually underground, so you cannot see it from the air, but it is painted on this aerial photograph.
Yeah, 当然没办法看到，事实上它是在地底下的。那这个是你画在这个空照图上面而已。
And you can sort of see how big this is by comparing the size of the runways at an airport.
你可以想象这东西到底有多大呢？经由与这个机场的一个大小的比较。
And this whole 27-kilometer tunnel is filled with very high-tech equipment.
基本上整个通道里面都被填满了这非常高科技的一个装备。
So even though the tunnel is a ring, you can barely see its curve because it's so big.
Yeah, 基本上这个通道呢，其实是一个圆形，但是因为它这么大，所以你即使这样看，你没有看得出来它是一个弯曲的线。
The particle accelerator may sound like something very strange and unfamiliar to you.
粒子加速器是一个对你来说应该是一个奇怪而且又非常不熟悉的一个东西。
Clearly, you don't have one of those in your backyard.
当然，你在你家后面不可能有这种东西了。
But there are actually many, many particle accelerators around you. This is a map of Japan, for example.
事实上有到处都有所谓的粒子加速器，比如说这样的列在日本的地图上面的这些。
In Japan, there are thousands of particle accelerators, mostly at hospitals.
在日本至少有上千个粒子加速器，通常他们都在医院里面。
They are used for treating cancer.Or image your body to identify where the cancer is.
多半都是用来被治疗炎症癌症，或者是被用来取出这个癌症所相对应的影像。
I used to tell people that there's one accelerator at your home too.
也许你需要这样的一个加速器在你的家存在你的家里面。
That's the old TV set where you actually shoot.The beam of electron onto the screen, and that's how it lights up, and you can enjoy the TV shows.
这就是你家电视机，事实上它加速了一个电子打在荧幕上，然后让你看到你的电视的节目。
But I'm afraid many students here have never seen that kind of TV because everything is now LED displays.
不过很可能大部分的学生这里都没有看过这种古早的音像管电视，那现在都是带着 LCD 的时代。
But you have another kind of particle accelerator at your home.
那你还有另外一种粒子加速器在你的家里。
That's the microwave oven.
那就是你的微波炉。
You produce microwaves to heat up your food by using tiny accelerators and produce these radio waves.
事实上也是，这是微波炉也是一种加速器，它加速了这个产生这种无线电波，用来加热你的食物。
Anyway, You do have these many particle accelerators around you, but something as big as LHC exists only one in the whole world.
所以事实上有这么多的加速器在你的身边，当然只有一个特别大的东西 LGC， 那这是唯一的。
There you accelerate small particle called protons to incredible speed and energy, smash them together to redo what happened in the Big Bang.
在 LGC， 我们加速一个非常小的东西，叫做质子，然后能量非常的高，然后对撞，让我们逼近这个宇宙诞生之初的大爆炸的情形。
And from the collision of two very high energy protons, many many things come out.
当我们对撞两个能量非常高的质子的时候呢，很多的事情都可以发生。
And to collect them all and measure them, you need to build big machine like this one.
为了能够收集这个诞生出来的资料呢，我们需要建这么一个巨大的一个装备。
This is the CMS experiment which people here have built together.
这个就是我们的 CMS 实验，是在做的相当很多位一起建造出来的一个巨大机器。
So more than 2,000 people worked around the world to build components of this detector.Put them together and build this humongous detector.
在全世界超过2000个人呢一起工作，建造的他们的部件，然后在一起工作，然后做出这样一个侦测器。
And I was very surprised when I heard a rumor back in 2010 that they have already discovered the Higgs boson.
我非常讶异，在2001年的时候就已经听到了这个像是这个小道消息，这个 Higgs 希格斯波色子已经被发现了。
That didn't turn out to be true. The only thing they have discovered is Mr. Peter Higgs visiting this detector.
事实上当然不是，他是看到了真正的希格斯老先生来到了这个加速器侦测器的附近。
The real discovery happened last year.
真正的这个发现呢是在去年。
There are two rival groups. CMS is the group here. There's another group called Atlas.
这是被两个团队呢所发现的。那一个是 CMS 呢，就是在做这边很多的的人士，以及 Atlas Group。
Both groups have announced the discovery of new particle last year on July 4th。
很多人呢就是产生出这个去年在7月4号的这个发现呢，这个希格斯波色子的发现的贡献。
When I watched this announcement of discovery back at home in California, I literally wept.
当我看到这个样的一个发现的一个消息呢，在我家里面是在，而且是在加州的家里面呢，我开始冒汗了。
I was so moved to witness this historic moment of humanity.
掉眼泪 ，sorry， 抱歉，掉眼泪。我掉眼泪，因为我看到这个时刻的感动，这件事情我非常的感动。
It is indeed historic because the Peter Higgs is proposed this particle something like half a century ago.
因为Peter Higgs 的先生呢，他在半世纪前呢，预言或是预测了这个东西的存在。
And some of our friends here have started to think about doing an experiment to test this idea some 30 years ago.
这边有不少的人士呢，是在这边人士呢，在30年前呢，想说我们要来做个实验，来测试这一点的东西的存在。
And it took something like 15 years to build this big accelerator and these big detectors.
花了大概15年左右来建造整个装备detector 包括这个侦测器的部分。
That's why this was such a historic moment.
这就是为什么它是一个历史的性的时刻。
And especially that this happened on July 4th, which is the Independence Day in the United States.
在去年发表的时候是在7月4号，也就是我们的独立纪念日。
We all celebrated the Higgs Independence Day.
对，我们就同时庆祝这个希格斯独立纪念日。
This is the rival experiment called Atlas.
这是其中一个实验 ，Atlas 侦测器。
You can see how big this is by looking at the size of the humans around this detector.
你可以看得出来这个东西有多大，就从这个上面的人小人的一个比较，你就知道这个装备有多大。
And this name Atlas is actually the ancient Greek god supporting the globe.
Atlas 其实是来自一个古希腊的一个名字的一个众神的名字，是这样，是来自这个像雕像，是一个巨人。
So it is meant to be big，
所以就是要很大就对了。
So it is something like 22 meters high，
大概有22个公尺高。
Compared to this, CMS actually means compact muon solenoid. It's only 50 meters high.
所以拿来比较的话 ，CMS 其实全名其实是紧凑苗子线圈，它只有15公尺高。
And just to see what these experiments do, this is a video of Atlas experiment. You see particle smashing and producing all kinds of particles.
那这个是一个展示呢，这是 Atlas 侦测器呢，当一个 particle 对撞它的一个影片。
You see what movie thereafter.So these experiments are put together also by thousands of physicists from around the world.
这个实验也是被几千个科学家一起工作做出来的一个巨大的一个实验。
And this is one picture during the construction. Again, you see the size of a human in this picture.
这一张照片是在建造一半过程所拍下来，你也可以再度比较一个人的大小以及整个机器的大小。
Even though this is a collection of high-tech machines, it has certain kind of beauty, and this picture became very famous.
其实它是一个高科技的装备呢，因为它有一种某种的美丽的对称性呢，使得这一张照片被引用的次数非常的高。
That's why this picture also had an influence in the world of art. This is an opera.
即使这样的东西，这个对于艺术界也有很大，艺文界有很大影响。这个其实是一个歌剧。
Looks very avant-garde.
我翻译一下，这个是白辽士的那个是什么特洛伊人吧。
And these detectors are not only big, but very complicated.
那这个侦测器 SAMS 侦测器呢，它不止大，而且它还非常的紧凑。
And using these complicated machines, they announced the discovery of the God particle.
用这样一个复杂的机器呢，他们发布了这个发现的这个粒子呢，神之粒子。
Actually, this name, the God particle, came from a book written by a Nobel laureate, Leon Littlemann.
事实上，这个名字来自一本书呢，是雷德曼写的一本书。
So the name is meant to say how important this particle is.
书名就是告诉大家这个粒子有多重要。
But the real story I heard is that Leon was very unhappy that it was so difficult to discover this particle. He called it goddamn particle.
这个名字主要来源其实是李昂雷德曼呢，他其实很不喜欢这个东西，而叫他该死的粒子。
But the publisher told him, well, with that kind of title, you can never sell this book.
不过很可惜的是，书上告诉他，如果你用这样的 title, 你这本书永远不用卖了。
So that's why the name was changed to the God Particle.
这就是为什么名字被改成了上帝的粒子。
So how was this discovery made?
这就是这个名字怎么的来源。
You bring beams of photons from one direction against the other direction. You smash them in the middle of these detectors.
有一个质子从一边从另外一边加速，然后对撞在中间，然后就产生了很多很多的粒子。
That produces many many particles, but sometimes you see the debris of the Higgs boson.
你会虽然看到非常的粒子飞出来，但是有时候你会看到像是希格斯波质子所留下来的一个踪迹。
It is so hard to build the Higgs boson, that's why it's so precious, but it falls apart right away.
希格斯波质是这么样的难被产生呢，也被难侦测呢，它在诞生之初就瞬间就衰变了。
All you can see is the fragments of the Higgs boson.
你看到其实像是它的衰变的之后的产物。
In this picture, what you see is the two particles of light that came from the Higgs boson that fell apart.
在你这张图上看到这两个光点呢，其实是两个光子呢，来自这个希格斯波色子的衰变。
But this is exactly what had been predicted by Mr. Higgs' theory.
这其实就是 exactly 希格斯所预测的该要发生的一个现象。
Sometimes Higgs boson fragments into different kinds of particles.
很多时候呢，希格斯波色子衰变成不同的粒子。
In this case, you see these four lines. These are particles called muons.
有时候你会看到四条线呢，它其实是所谓的苗子。
And you're looking for only like tens or hundreds of these events.
你从很多很多的事，从大概数十个很多很多事件里面找出大概数十个事件这样子。
After repeating these questions a quadrillion times.
就是在我们撞了quadrillion，其实是十的十五次方那么多的对撞。
And each collision is actually very messy.
事实上，而且事实上，这个对撞呢是非常非常的复杂，非常非常的混乱。
It is incredible that our friends managed to dig out so few events out of this big mess.
这是非常了不起的事情。我们的这边的朋友呢，有办法从这么多复杂东西挑出这个数十个事件。
That shows they are very patient, very smart, worked hard, and also that, what do you want to say? Well, anyway.
这是展示我们的我们的伙伴们是这么样的有耐心，这么样的仔细，以及这么样的忘记在说什么。
And also, without incredible development of computer technology, this kind of thing would not have been possible.
当然，这还依赖我们这个在电脑科技上的进步呢，否则我们根本没办法处理这样的一个事件。
And this is such a major discovery. I'm sure there will be Nobel prizes, and these are the people as candidates.
当然，这么一个重要的东西，他们绝对是诺贝尔奖的候选人。那这些是关系人士。
But unfortunately, Mr. Nobel Prize passed away in 2011.
很不幸的Mr. Bob 在2011年的时候已经过世了。
So you see, one very important thing to be successful in science is to stay healthy and live long.
所以你注意到，这是一件非常重要的事情，在科学界呢，你必须要能够健康而且活得久。
Okay, but then why is this particle so important for us?
那但是为什么这个例子对我们是这么的重要？
Because this really has to the question why or where we came from.
这是因为这个例子真的是跟我们从哪里来和从何处来这个问题是有关的。
For example, we cannot live without our sun.
就像是举个例子吧，我们没有办法如果没有太阳，我们就活不下去。
But how does the sun burn?
但是太阳是怎么燃烧的？
It turns out the sun is bringing together two protons to form helium, just like what happened in the Big Bang.
事实上呢，太阳就是把一些质子凑在一起呢，产生这个氦呢，就像是在宇宙大爆炸诞生之初所发生的事情。
But I tried to put them on a scale so that four protons, initially, actually are heavier than the product of helium.
我事实上把它放在一个天平上面，你会发现四个质子其实比一个氦核要来的重一些。
This is very strange, isn't it?
这是很奇怪的，对吧？
Imagine you have two cars crashing against each other.
你可以想象说有两个东西叫做交错过去。
You find many degrees on the ground.
你发现
You find many degrees on the ground.
一大堆的，我还可以看到碎片 ，OK， 一大的碎片在地上。
But if you collect them all and weigh them, that should be exactly the same mass as the sum of two cars at the beginning.
如果你把它们通通拿起来并且称啊，它们应该要跟一开始的车是一样重的。
But here you see a part of the weight is lost.
但是你会发现有一部分的重量呢却消失了。
That's exactly how the sun burns.
这就是太阳如何燃烧。
This is the famous equation by Einstein.
这就是爱因斯坦非常著名的公式。
It says mass m.Is the same thing as energy E.
这告诉我们质量 m 就跟能量 E 是一样的东西。
If you lose mass, you can make energy.
如果你失去了质量，你可以换得能量。
As a matter of fact, sun burns and releases so much energy by getting lighter by 4 million tons every second.
事实上，太阳每秒钟会损失400万吨的重量。
I would be very happy if I take some of my mass off to create energy.
如果我可以拿我的一部分的质量的体重来换取能量的话，我会非常的开心。
But exactly that is what our sun is doing.
这其实就是我们太阳在做的事情。
And as you can see, there are some byproducts.Called tiny particles neutrinos in this reaction.
事实上，你会看到它有一些副产品，就像是非常小的粒子呢，我们叫做微中子。
Even though we cannot see this reaction happening at the center of the sun, we can actually see these neutrinos streaming out of the sun.
即使我们没办法看到太阳里面的反应呢，但是这些微中子呢，会从太阳内部呢溢释出来。
And so many neutrinos come up from the sun as we speak. About 100 trillion neutrinos are going through your body every second.
有这么多的微中子被太阳制造出来，其实我们每秒钟有100兆个这微中子穿过你的身体。
Even though you are underground, these neutrinos are so tiny, they can pass through this entire building completely easily and still going through your body.
即使我们现在在地底下呢，这个微中子是这么样的这么样的小呢，它是可以穿过整个建筑物这个地板呢，到直接还是穿过你的身体。
Even during the night, when the sun is on the other side of the earth, the neutrinos can go through the entire earth also very easily. So as you sleep on your bed,This many neutrinos are going through your body.
所以即使晚上呢，太阳其实是在地球另外一边呢，这微中子呢还是照样穿过整个地球，还有包括你的身体。所以即使你在睡觉，它还是继续穿过你的身体。
Does any of you feel this wind of neutrinos coming from the sun?
有没有任何人你感觉到这个从太阳射过来这个微中子的风呢
？No. When I ask this question in America, there are always a couple of people who raise their hand.
如果我在美国问这个问题，一定会有些人举手说他们可以。
I can see people in Taiwan are far more sensitive and reasonable.
我发现台湾的人比较 max 比较有 sense 也比较有理性。
The reason why this neutron is important is that this is telling us this reaction happens due to some very special force called the weak force.
这些微中子在太阳里面被产生出来，是靠了一个非常特别的力呢，我们叫做弱作用力。
And the real evidence that this reaction is powering the sun came out only rather recently.
事实上这样的东西呢，我们对这样的了解是非常最近才理解的。
Because neutrinos interact so little and pass through everything so easily, the only hope is to build a big target.Hoping that once in a while neutrinos may interact.
因为这微中子这么容易穿透任何东西，所以唯一能够捕捉它们的方法就是要建一个非常非常大的一个目标呢，使得它希望它不小心可以反应。
These little ghosts are neutrinos. They typically pass through this even big tank, but once in a while, this shy neutrino gets seen.
像这个幽魂一样，在这么一个巨大的侦测器里面呢，它不小心才会被中间的这个幽魂给看到。
This is a tank built underground in Japan that has 50,000 tons of water.
这是一个巨大的水桶，巨大的水槽呢，在日本所建造出来的。
Even with this big target and so many neutrinos coming from the sun, they get to see only like 5 of them every day.
其实一个这么大的一个水缸呢，而且又这么多的微中子每天穿过呢，我们一天也只能看到五次的反应。
But if you wait enough, collect the data for 5 years, have a long exposure, you can use these neutrinos to take a picture of the sun.
如果你再有够有耐心，等得够久呢，你可以用这些微中子呢来替太阳照相。
So if you happen to live underground.This is the way you discover the sun.
如果你不小心是其实住在地底呢，这就是你唯一能够看到太阳的方式。
But what is this weak force?
那到底什么是弱作用呢？
As far as we can tell, the weak force looks very similar to the familiar force of electromagnetic forces, electric and magnetic forces.
实际上这个弱作用呢，跟我们很熟悉的一种作用，也就是电磁作用力呢，是非常相似的。
But there is one big difference between them.
但他们有一个非常巨大的差距。
As you know, for example, magnetic force is long range.
就像你知道的一样，就像这个电磁作用力呢是非常可以作用的距离是非常远的。
If you hold a compass in your hand, the needle gets pulled by the north pole of the earth and points to the north correctly.
如果你有一个指南针或者北针呢，这个针的指的方向呢，就指的你的比如指的你的北极的方向。
So you can see magnetic force goes all the way around the world, and electric force is also long range.
所以你看到这个磁力呢，其实是可以穿过整个世界的。那电磁作用力电磁力也是电力也是一样的。
But weak force goes over only tiny bit.
但是如果做望远镜其实是只能走一点点的距离。
It goes over only a billionth of a nanometer.
它只能走大概十亿分之一个纳米。
This is the problem Mr. Peter Higgs really, really wanted to understand.
这就是我们的希格斯先生呢真的想要知道的一件事情。
How do very similar forces have such a different ranges?
为什么这么相似的力呢，却有这么大的差？关于这个作用力的距离，却有差距这么大
？And that's the question that have been answered by assuming that a new particle is filling up the entire universe.
这个要达到这件事情呢，就是假设有一种新的粒子呢，填充了整个宇宙。
Just to get the picture of this, imagine the universe was really, really hot at the beginning, just like this vapor coming out from the volcano.
如果想象在宇宙诞生之初呢，宇宙是非常非常的热，就像这个蒸汽在于火山口附近的蒸汽。
Anything hot has these tiny particles moving about in completely random and chaotic way。
这些所有的这些水蒸气的分子的粒子呢，它都随意的行动，而且没有任何的关系。
In the case of vapor, they are water molecules。
如果它是蒸汽的话，基本上就是水分子。
In a similar way, at the beginning of the universe, Higgs particle had been moving about in a completely random and chaotic way.
在想象在宇宙诞生之初呢，这些希格斯玻色子呢，就像这个蒸汽分子一样呢，随意的行动。
But as you cool things down, in the case of vapor, eventually that freezes into ice.
那如果你把东西慢慢的冷却，如果今天是一个水蒸气的话，它最后就变成了冰了。
And once they freeze in, they line up very neatly in a very ordered fashion.
那就所有东西就堆积起来，变得非常有秩序的一个情形。
In the same way, we believe that Higgs particle got all frozen in to the empty space of the universe.
那我们想象呢，就是像是如果你想象希格斯粒子呢，就是慢慢的冷却，最后也填满了扎实的填满整个空间。
That's the way the Higgs boson started out with this disorder, and then created an order to the universe.
这就像是这个水蒸气变成冰一样呢，替这个宇宙的制造了秩序。
In the case of water, it freezes at 0°C.
如果是水的话，它是在零度 C 的时候变成了冰。
In the case of the Higgs boson, it froze into the universe when the universe became as cold as 4 quadrillion degrees.
如果是希格斯粒子的话，它会在后面有15个零度变成了像是固体一样的东西。
And after the Higgs boson froze into the empty space, all the other particles have to move.Inside this mess of the Higgs boson,
如果像希格斯粒子已经变成像固体一样的东西，所有其他东西都必须要在这个空间里面移动。
Light doesn't realize that there is a Higgs boson around it and can keep going at the speed of light.
如果是光的话，它根本不管这个希格斯玻色子，它就继续往前进，走的就跟光速一样。
Other particles we know get slowed down and can't go very far anymore.
所有其他的粒子呢，全部都被减速了，而且它没办法走得更远。
And that's how the weak force stops going over long distance and stopped within a billionth of nanometer.
这就是为什么弱作用力呢，它很快的就被停下来，而且它只能走那个十亿分之一个纳米那么远。
That's also how the electrons got slowed down so that they can happily move about inside atomic atoms.
这也就是为什么电子呢，它可以被减速，而且最后形成了可以循着在原子核外面的围绕。
So if you manage to heat up the universe and Higgs boson evaporates, then the electrons start moving and flying apart with the speed of light.
如果你把整个宇宙加热呢，那这个希格斯玻色子不再是这样的一个固定的形式的时候，电子开始会开始移走，加速变，最后以光速跑掉了。
Then your body would evaporate in about a billionth of a second.
那就代表你的身体呢，会在十亿分之一秒呢，就白白的就蒸发掉了。
You don't want that to happen, do you?
我相信你并不想要这个发生，对吧
then you gotta know about the Higgs boson.
所以你必须要知道这个波色子在搞什么。
And after this discovery, I was invited to a TV show.
在这个发现之后，我被请到这个 TV 的这个电视的节目。
The newscast asked me the following question, Mr. Murayama, you tell me that our whole space is filled with this Higgs boson. Why don't we notice it?
这主持人问我，春山先生，如果这宇宙都被填满了这个希格斯波士子，为什么我一点感觉都没有呢？
So I have to think about how to answer this question for a while.
所以我得稍微想一想，我到底怎么回答这个问题。
Then I said, well, that's because it's just like the air.
事实上这个东西就跟空气一样。
You know, ancient people didn't know that we live in the air.
事实上古代人根本不知道我们是住在空气里面。
You can't touch it, you can't see it, you can't hear it, you can't smell it, you can't taste it.
你看不到，摸不到，尝不到，听不着，记不起来了，对不起。
So how do you know there's air around you?
那你怎么知道你附近都是充满了空气？
That's probably because you were told that the air is around you from your parents or from teachers. You haven't figured this out yourself.
就是你这事实上是被你的父母、老师、朋友告诉你说有空气的流动带来的风，让你知道有空气的存在。
But if there is a motion, sometimes you can tell something's out there.
如果那边有一些移动的话，你就可以知道有些东西是存在的。
That's the wind.
那就是风了。
So if there is a motion of the air, you feel the wind, and you can tell something is out there.
如果有风的话，你会有些感触，所以你知道有东西在那边的存在。
But still, ancient people thought there's something called wind, not the air.
但是有些古代人还认为这个东西叫做冷的风，而不是空气。
So this is the way it's so difficult to tell you are inside something and you take that for granted because you were born into that kind of world.
这就是发现，当你有时候非常难区分，你是周遭的东西，尤其是当你诞生之初就活在它里面。
So in the same way, if you can create motion of this ocean of the Higgs boson, maybe you can tell.
如果你有办法让整个希格斯粒子形成的海呢有移动的话，你就有办法感受到它。
But the Higgs boson is frozen so rigidly in space, you can't really move it.
那可是事实上，这个希格斯波子就像是冻结成固体一样，在整个空间里面，你没办法移动它。
But it's right here and right there and right there.
那就在这里、那里还有那里。
So the idea is that if you can strike hard enough, maybe you can knock out one of those Higgs boson.
如果你可以敲得够用力的话，也许你可以敲出一颗希格斯波色子。
That's exactly what the LHC experiment has done.
这就是我们在 LHC 实验做的事情。
By smashing protons at incredible energy, you put so much energy into empty space.
但使用这能量这么高的质子呢，对撞的时候，你等于是把这对一个真空里面用力的敲它。
But empty space is actually not empty.
事实上，这真空不是真的真空。
It's filled with Higgs boson.
事实上是充满了希格斯波色子。
So this energy struck one of these Higgs bosons out, and that's what they have seen.
我们要把这些能量用力的往这个真空里面能量敲呢，然后你可以产生的这个希格斯波色子，事实上这就是你看到的东西。
And after listening to my response, then she asked me the question, "Okay, Mr. Murayama, then how can we explain this important role of the Higgs boson to the viewers of this TV show?"
在我这样的解释之后，主持人问了我，那我要怎么样子对在 TV show 里面对一般大众解释这个东西到底有多重要呢？
Again, I have to think very hard about this question.
我必须还是想好好的想想这个答案。
So then I asked them, "Well, please bring in many small children."
所以我就这么说了，请你们带来很多很多的小朋友。
The early universe was like during the break of the kindergarten, where all these small children are running around in a completely chaos.
宇宙诞生之初就像这些小朋友到处跑来跑去，就像一团的混沌。
as a person with small children, I can tell that kindergartners never walk together. They are completely on their own.
对于一个 有父母有小育儿经验的父母呢，可以告诉你说在幼稚园这些小朋友是完全没有关系的随意的行动。
But then comes the magician called the Higgs boson.
但是他们这边来一个魔术师，就是希格斯玻色子。
And this magician cast spell on these small children.
这魔术师对这个小朋友施了一个咒语。
Then they all slow down.Calm down and sit there at individual desks.
他们就减速了，而且变得凉了，然后变形成了这样的一个结构。
This is what happened in our universe.
这就是我们宇宙发生的事情。
These desks are atomic nuclei. The kids are electrons, and this is how the atoms were born.
这些桌子呢，就是原子核，这些小朋友就是电子，那这就是我们称作原子的东西。
This is how the Higgs boson brought order to the universe.
这就是为什么希格斯玻色子对宇宙带来的秩序。
But the problem is that we don't know who this magician is.
但是问题就是我们不知道这个魔术师到底干了什么。
This magician is faceless.
这个魔术师叫做无脸男。
Even though we have found it, we don't know who he is. Is he alone? Does he have any siblings? Why did he get frozen into the universe?
其实我们找到了他，但是我们不知道他是什么。他是不是孤独的？他有没有任何的兄弟姐妹？那而且最后怎么样子让这个整个宇宙冻结
？Because we haven't understood any of these questions yet.We are still not sure where we came from.
既然我们还没有了解这些问题，我们并没有办法真正了解我们到底从何来的这个基本问题。
And Higgs boson is really faceless, like this guy here.
事实上，希格斯玻色子是真的没有脸，就像这个家伙一样。
Or maybe like this one.
就像这个墙壁怪一样。
And what I mean by faceless is actually this.
什么东西叫做脸呢？实际上就是这个。
Every elementary particles we have discovered so far are spinning forever.
事实上，到目前为止，我们发现的所有的基本粒子呢，它们都会转。
Just like a top.
就像一个陀螺一样。
Electrons, photons, quarks, all of these particles are spinning forever.
电子啊，光子呢，还有夸克呢，它们都不断的在转。
Light particles coming from that lamp.Come into your eyes, always spinning.
即使这光呢，从那个灯泡打到你的眼睛呢，它都一直在转。
But this new particle doesn't spin.
但是这个新的粒子呢，它不喜欢转。
The particles that are spinning, it looks different from the way you actually look at this particle. So they got faces.
对一个会转的粒子呢，你用不同的角度去看它，你会看到不同的东西，因此它们有脸。
But Higgs boson looks exactly the same, no matter how you look at it. It doesn't have a face.
但是希格斯玻色子呢，因为它不转，所以不管你用什么角度去看它呢，看起来都是一样，所以它没有脸。
So it's kind of spooky.
这是一个像幽灵般的存在。
Because I found this idea of faceless particles so strange and spooky, I did not believe in it when I first heard of this idea back in my graduate school.
当回到我是在研究生的年代，当我第一次听到这个希格斯玻色子是一个没有脸的东西呢，是这么样的像幽灵一样的东西呢，我根本不相信它。
So my dream during my graduate study is to come up with a theory that doesn't have Higgs boson, and I eventually proposed Higgsless theories.
所以当我在研究生的年代，或是将来我的一个梦想就是要能够设计出一个理论呢，是不存在希格斯的粒子的理论。
But now that it's discovered, I was wrong.
那现在这都被发现，所以我错了。
Being a proper Japanese, I have to apologize like this.
既然我是一个正统的日本人，所以我必须要像这样子道歉。
But it still leaves these big questions.
但是这问题依然存在。
Is what we have discovered really the only one of this type?
如果我们问题就是我们看到这东西真正的就是只有它吗
？Or maybe this is the beginning of the faceless family of particles.
也许这个只是刚开始找到一大堆没有脸的 particle.
Namely, it may have siblings or relatives.
那他们可能有很多的兄弟姐妹或是亲戚。
There are also other ideas. Maybe this Higgs boson is actually spinning. but it's spinning in other dimensions we cannot see, and that's why it may look like it's not spinning.
也许这个西格斯波特它其实是有脸的，它其实在转，只是它转的方向是在不同的次元里面转，所以只是在我们次元我们看不到它。
Or maybe this particle is not elementary and it has small parts inside that are spinning, or they cancel against each other.
也许这个希格斯粒子呢，其实根本不是基本粒子，而是有结构的，有两个有会转的东西在它里面呢，然后它们互相的抵触，所以导致你看起来像是没有 spin.
And one of the real nature of this particle is we still would like to understand why this particle got frozen in the universe.
那即使如此，我们还是要知道这个粒子本身的特性呢？为什么它使这个宇宙被冷冻了下来
？Maybe this idea of extra dimension space sounds so far-fetched, like science fiction.
也许这个主义像是增加更多的次元呢，就是这么的奇妙，就像是科幻小说一样。
But the physicists are seriously thinking that maybe our world is not three-dimensional, or maybe nine-dimensional.
也许很多科学家也许在思考这个问题，也许我们的宇宙并不是三个次元，也许是更高维度的空间。
Small curved dimensions are everywhere in space.
小小卷曲的维度呢，在整个空间里面充满着。
But if they are very small, we may not see them.
因为它们很小，所以我们看不到。
For example, dimensions mean how many ways you can move.
OK， 帮我数数，我有多少个方向可以移动
？In our universe, we can move up and down, left and right, front and back. They are the three dimensions.
在宇宙里面，我可以上下、前后、左右移动，它们有三个维度。
Think about this person walking on the road.
想想看，这个人呢，在这个绳子上面走路。
She can go only to the front and back.So for her, there is only one dimension of space.
对她来说，她只能前以及后走，所以对她来说，这个是一个一次元的空间，一维度的空间。
But small ants on this rope can not only go front and back, but also go round the rope.
对一个蚂蚁在上面呢，它可以不止往前往后走，也可以这样子绕圈圈。
So the ants see two dimensions.
所以对蚂蚁来说，它其实是个二维的空间。
Even though big things like us may see only one dimension.Small things like elementary particles may see more dimensions to space.
像我们这么大的东西，我们也许看起来只像是一个维度的空间，但是对很小的东西，像是基本粒子而言，它也许看起来像是个更高维度的世界。
So if the Higgs boson is spinning in these tiny dimensions, we think they are not spinning.
也许这个希格斯波子在这个高维度空间里面旋转，只是在我们的空间里面看不出来。
So maybe the Higgs boson is a messenger from extra dimensions.
也许希格斯波子只是一个来自高维度次元的一个信息者，信差。Yeah.
And once you find something really strange, you would like to look very closely.
如果你看到任何奇怪的东西，你总是想要仔细的观察。
And we know what to do in the case of astronomy.
我们知道，对科研文学来说，我们知道怎么去做。
If you find an object that looks very strange, like this one, you would like to study it in many different ways.
如果你看到一个这么奇怪的东西，你会希望有很多种方法来研究它。
You can observe the same object using X-rays, optical light, infrared light, and radio.
所以你可以用 X 光，然后一般的光，或者是红外线，或者是无线电波来观察它。
And once you do this kind of study, eventually you discover.That this strange object that looks like a heart is a result of a merger of two galaxies.
那当你做过多的研究之后，你会发现这个看起来像是一个爱心的形状的东西，其实是两个银河系在互相结合的状态。
So you would like to look at the same object with different instruments and understand what's really going on.
所以你会想要用各种不同的装备呢，来研究这个物体呢，看它到底发生了什么事情。
Because we discovered this Higgs boson with the LHC accelerator, we would like to continue doing so and understand this particle much better.
所以我们要做的事情就是在 LHC 发现了希格斯波子这个东西呢，我们要做的事情就是用更多的角度、更多的方式来研究它，也许我们可以了解的更多。
And many people here are actually planning to continue this study for the next 20 years.
事实上，在这边在座的很多人呢，已经在计划接下来二十年要继续研究这个玩意。
But at the same time, you would like to look at this protocol in a different way.
在同时之间，也许你可以看这个，用不同的角度来看这样一个新的例子。
That is an idea called international linear collider.
这就是我们称作国际线形对撞器的一个机器。
The LHC experiment throws these protons against each other.
LHC 呢，实际上是对撞这两个质子。
But protons are complicated object because they are made of three quarks bound together like gluons.
事实上，质子是一个非常复杂的东西呢，它是由三个夸克组成，而且是用胶质粘在一起的。
So this experiment is like throwing two mochis against each other.
这样一个实验其实是等于是拿两个红豆大福对撞做出来的东西。
What you really want to study is the collision of two red beans.
你要做的事情，实际上你想要做的是对撞两个红豆。
But you can see this red bean paste would give you such a goo, so it's very difficult to pick out what's going on.
你可以看到像这些这个对撞之后的红豆的产物会产生各式各样的东西，让你很难去了解它到底做出了什么东西。
If you can throw red beans against each other, that's much simpler to understand.
如果你可以拿一颗红豆打另外一个红豆，日子就好过多了。
But you can easily see the mochi may be easy to throw. These beans are hard to throw.
你马上就可以发现到这个红豆大福很容易就可以丢出去，可是这个红豆却很难射出去。
It's also easy to make these big things smash against each other, but getting these small things smashing against each other is a lot harder.
你可以马上发现这两个大福要对撞比较相对来说容易的多，比起两个红豆来说容易的多。
So the idea is to smash these small things against each other, namely electrons and their counterparts called positrons.
在这里我们就是要对撞一个东西，就这边对应的就是电子以及它的反物质，也就是正子。
As a matter of fact, this is so hard to do.Until just the last year, we were not quite sure if we can actually do this kind of experiment.
那事实上，这个是非常的困难。即使到去年为止，我们还没有办法完全的确定我们可以做这件事情。
But at the end of the last year, we came up with a design of such a machine. Now we think we can actually do this experiment.
一直到去年底，我们总算设计出了一个这样的一个机器，然后我们认为我们可以开始做这样的一个实验了。
So what you do is produce these electron and positrons at the center and bring them apart by about 15 kilometers to the end.
你要做的事情就是在中间产生这个电子呢，以及正子呢，把它拉到整个50公里远处。
They turn around and get accelerated inside this yellow tube.
他们接着在这个黄色的管子里面加速。
And what's outside here provides the radio waves.That actually produces a kick on the electrons.
那在外这外侧会产生所谓的无线电波呢，会产生像用来踢这个电子的一个作用。
Because radio waves are waves, what you basically want to do is like a surfing.
就事实上这是一个电子事实上在无线电波像是一个 wave， 所以这个像是波，所以电子上做一个冲浪的一个动作。
You stay on the wavefront so that you get little kicks many, many times, get accelerated, and smash them in the middle.
这电子呢，在站在这个波的上面呢，不断像那个冲浪呢，然后不断的加速，然后最后像对撞的结果。
So this is the way we think we can understand the nature of the Higgs boson much better.
这就是我们认为这个方式呢，让我们认为这个方式可以让我们更加的了解希格斯波质子的本质。
So if you watch a person you never met before very carefully, maybe you can tell a person is married or not.
如果你看一个人，你不了解，但是你看很仔细的话，你可以至少可以知道他是结过婚的没有，看他的手戒指就知道了。
And understand his habits, character, and eventually what kind of life he has.
你就可以慢慢了解他的兴趣、他的个性以及他的过了什么样的生活。
So we would like to watch the behavior of this new particle very closely using both LHC and this new type of machine called IOC.
所以我们要做的事情就是仔细地观察这个新的粒子呢 那使用两个，你使用两个机器，就是 LGC 呢，以及这个新的新型加速器 ILC。
Only after that, we think we can understand the question: Why did this particle freeze in for the universe?
之后我们就可以靠这方式来了解这个问题，就是为什么这个 particle 这个粒子呢，使得宇宙被冷冻起来了。
And once it does, we do understand that question. We actually understand the moment when the Higgs boson froze into a space, which is when the universe was only like a trillionth of a second old.
借此呢，我们就可以更往前时间推进了，让我们了解只有在宇宙的百亿分之一秒左右的时间的宇宙。
That way, we hope to get so much back to the beginning of the universe.
这让我们更是接近了宇宙的诞生之初。
Then we can finally start answer the question where we came from.
那我们总算可以靠这个来回答这个最主要问题：我们到底从何而来
？But as you have as I said at the very beginning, there are many other kinds of mysteries about the universe.
就像在我一开始所介绍，这边有非常非常多宇宙的神秘现象。
For example, 80% of matter in the universe is not made of atoms we are made of.
比如说在宇宙诞生之初，很多东西并不是像原子一样，像我们是由原子构成的。
It is called dark matter.
这我们叫做暗物质。
And Higgs boson may help us understand what this dark matter is.
希格斯波子可以帮助我们了解什么叫做暗物质。
Because maybe this Higgs boson might also fragment into dark matter particles once in a while.
也许这个希格斯波子有一定的机会可以变成暗物质。
As you can see, the dark matter is even more spooky than the Higgs boson.
大家发现这个暗物质绝对比这个Higgs boson 呢更加的诡异。
It turns out dark matter is also important to the question where we came from.
当然，这个暗物质呢也非常接近我们从何来的这个基本问题。
Because dark matter actually formed the stars in galaxies.
事实上，暗物质呢形成了我们的星球以及我们的银河。
So without dark matter, you wouldn't be here either.
如果没有暗物质，你也没办法生活在这里。
So maybe a better study of the Higgs boson would tell what dark matter particle actually is, so that we also understand what the universe is actually made of.
借由研究希格斯粒子，也许我们可以更接近这暗物质，让我们了解宇宙的怎么样的被形成。所以。我们更知道宇宙是怎么样被制造出来的。
And finally, we also would like to understand the fate of the universe too.
我们当然也可以想要知道宇宙的命运会如何。
We know it's expanding, it's actually speeding up.
我们知道它事实上在扩展扩大，然后而且它在增加的速度。
Does it go on forever? Does it keep accelerating? Or does it actually lead to an end of the universe?
它是继续扩展，还是继续加速？然后还什么时候是宇宙的终结
？And to answer this question, I'm working on another project called SUBMARINE.
为了要了解这东西，我参与了另外一个研究，叫做 SUBMARINE.
You can look very far away using big telescopes like the Subaru telescope built by Japan.
你可以这样这个研究里面，我们可以利用一个非常大的望远镜，叫斯巴鲁望远镜呢，看得非常的远。
Using big telescopes, what you would like to do is a kind of census of the universe.
用这个方式，你可以探测这个宇宙用这样巨大的望远镜可以探测宇宙。
For example, if you would like to understand the future of a country, you would like to understand.How quickly the country is aging by looking at big data sample of the demographics of the country.
如果你要研究整个国度的一个变化，你要看一个巨大的一个资料呢，来研究这个整个国家的老化的程度。
If the only person I meet in Taiwan is Jack, I might think this country is very young.
如果在台湾唯一碰到的就是是捷克的话，就是我会发现也许整个国家是非常的年轻。
On the other hand, if the only person I see in this country is George, I might think Taiwan is getting very old.
如果在台湾遇到唯一的人是侯老师的话，那我也想象台湾其实年纪非常大。
So meeting two people is clearly not enough.
所以只遇过两个人是完全不够的。
You need to study many, 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 many things to understand the future of the universe.
你必须要做非常非常多事情才能了解整个宇宙。
For this purpose, you need to use a telescope with a large field of view.
因为达成这个，你需要一个望远镜能有可以看非常宽广的一个的视角。
To collect enough sample with a famous Hubble telescope, it may take thousands of years.
如果同样的东西，如果要用Hubble望远镜的话，要花上千年了。
By then, my graduate students will be really, really old.
如果是研究生的话，那是已经是要做非常非常多年的事情了。
But if your telescope had a large field of view, you may be able to do this in just a couple of years.
如果有一个这么样大的视角的望远镜呢，就可以同样事情只需要几年就可以做得到。
For this purpose, we built a new camera for the telescope, which is a digital camera, just like what you carry in your cell phone.
为了做到这个事情，我们在上面装了一个新的摄影机。它的东西基本上就像是你装在手机里面的东西类似。
But unlike typical digital camera that may have a few million pixels, this one has almost 1 billion pixels.
这个东西不像是你只有几百万画素的摄影机，那它这个东西有上亿的画素。
And it weighs 3 tons.
它只有三种。
And using this new camera, we hope to observe almost 1 billion galaxies to get enough sample of the universe.
我们想要使用这样的一个望远镜呢，可以看很多很多的这个银河呢，取得足够多的实验数据。
And then we also would like to measure the color of each galaxy very carefully.
我们也想要测量这些银河的颜色，非常的仔细。
And combination of them would give us a good census of the universe.
我们把这两样装备啊装备起来，就可以让我们侦测这宇宙非常的清晰。
And this is the kind of things we are trying to do.
这就是我们现在要尝试要做的事情。
So we are trying to understand how the universe began, and that has to do with the Higgs boson and dark matter.
这就是我们现在要想办法了解呢，宇宙到底怎么。
We also like to know if there's an end.
不知道它有没有一个结束。
And they all have to do with the question where we came from, why we exist.
都跟我们为何存在这个问题扯上了关系。
And we look for these light particles coming from the galaxies billions of light years away.
我们看这些光来自宇宙诞生之初。
They find the Milky Way galaxy eventually Earth.
它经过了一个我们心里就心里的到我们这边。
Go into a big mirror that's has an 8 meter diameter.
到这边有一个八公尺的一个望远镜。
Get into these optical fibers for 50 meters.
这边有15公尺的光纤。
And find the spectrograph that can measure the color of object very well.
就到这个临近，那它可以区分它的光线，可以测它颜色。
This is another project that may go on for 10 years, so that we can do a good census of the universe.
所以这个接下来是10年，我们会做这样的一个专案，然后知道我们可以了解这个宇宙的部分。
And George told me that I'm not allowed to show this video because that's nothing to do with the CMS, but I wanted to show it anyway.
侯老师告诉我不可以秀这个，就局告诉我不可以秀这个影片，因为这个跟 LGC 一点关系都没有。
So you can see this project rocks.
所以你看这个研究主义衰弊了吧
？So this way, physicists asking really simple but profound questions.
这就是我们现在想回答的问题。
Like where do we come from?
我们从哪儿来？
Or what is the fate of the universe?
我们的命运会如何
？And we use many different techniques, many different tools to address these questions in a scientific way.
我们用各式各样的方式、不同的工具呢，来针对同样的一个问题。
That way, we physicists would like to win the battle against the mysteries of the universe. Thank you.
这就是我们用来对抗这个宇宙的宇宙的机密的一个武器。
Thank you for your attention.
Okay, first I have to. This is on?
Okay.
Hiroshi, first I have to correct you. Actually, what I told you was that your talk yesterday with this. Oh, okay.
Yeah. 我告诉你，我这其实跟我和你说的不一样。对，那是事实上我跟你讲是昨天的演讲。
So what I said is that yesterday, since it's a pure CMS audience, please don't show the summary.
因为昨天呢是全部都是跟 CMS 相关人士在场，请不要那个放这个跟 summary 有关的东西。
I said for this public lecture, it's very fine.
但是
rush，
所以对这个一般大众而言，这个是完全没有问题，而且 it rocks。
Well, that's great. So I still get dinner tonight.
那是太棒了，所以我还有晚餐吗？
Before I turn to questions, I think I want to do two introductions related to our lecture today. One thing is our former spokesperson sitting here, Guido Tonelli,
Professor Tonelli. We have our former speaker here, Guido 教授。
I just said, last December we had him for a public lecture on a similar theme.
事实上去年年底呢，我们请Guido 教授在这里给一个类似的演讲。
Not just that, I think in some of the video clips that Hiroshi or Mariama Sensei showed,
事实上有些东西是跟今天春山教授所展现出来的一些影片是有关系的。
Well, he was.In that, in those video clips, unfortunately, he had the back towards the camera.
事实上，他出现在这个影片里面，但是他其实是背对的那个摄像机镜头。
Mariama-san also mentioned Leon Lederman, Nobel laureate.
春山教授也提到了Leon Lederman这位诺贝尔奖得主。
Now, that's all. Introduce also Professor Bob Shum, faculty at NTU.
那我这边也介绍陈教授是台大的台大物理系的教授。
He was Leon Lederman was his advisor.
所以 Leon Lederman 就是我们熊老师的老师。
And Professor Shung is currently the president of our physical society.
那熊老师是目前我们物理学会的会长。
Okay, 我我们现在可以开放问答，你就直接 handle。
OK， 好，有没有任何的问题呢？
I have a very naive question. So how do we know that the Higgs boson particle is spinless? Is it based on the experimental evidence, or is it by construction in the model?
The question is, why Higgs boson is still there?
Why it's spinless?How do we know it's spinless?
That's based on observation. Our friends at CMS have looked at the property of this Higgs boson fragmented into many different particles. And if you actually think of something spinning, falling apart, you would think that everything sort of falls into this plane instead of moving outwards that way, right? So looking at how things come out, you can tell if the particle is spinning or not.
让我试着翻译一下。问题是这样子，是你怎么知道希格斯波子是不转的，没有自旋的？那孙山教授的回答是，这是由我们实验的同仁所研究出的研究结果显示，如果一个不转的东西，你让它衰变出来的话，它的分布呢，通常会是平的，因为它没有任何的关系。那可以借由这样的实验结果来验证它其实是没有带自旋的一个例子。
We have to make sure that is really the case.By still looking at this particle more closely, but so far it really looks like this particle is faceless.
对，理论上我们要更仔细的研究这个例子，确定这个是就是这样的一个现象。但是就目前为止的实验数据告诉我们，跟这个样的一个假设并没有什么不同，它看起来就像是没有脸一样的。
Do you agree, Guido? Yes.
Guido 教授说没有问题。 可能要挥手，挥得用力一点，真的很难看得出来。
I have a question regarding the Higgs boson particle siblings you mentioned in your lecture. According to my understanding, that according to the standard model of the particles, that Higgs boson stands alone as a category. Can you kind of elaborate on the part of the siblings part? Thank you.
主要是一个是粒子本身是被页面放在如果在我研究这个粒子学习这个粒子物理的部分呢，希格斯波粒子本身是被放在一个特别的位置，你可以解释一下更多的解释更多的部分吗？My translation is precise or 这样翻是这个意思吗？
Yeah, basically, but I was actually referring to the part 就是我是指说他有提到说为什么，就是他问说希格斯波色子是不是有兄弟姐妹，那我在想他的意思是不是说有他有相关的例子，但是在那个标准模型中他是自己是一个的吗？
Oh, okay, so maybe let me translate in other direction. Yeah, what he was asking is that his particle, he may have a siblings of relatives, so should we put them all together into a single category in the model of particle physics?
That's a very good question. For example, there is a theory called supersymmetry.
这个是一个很好的问题，我们有一个理论叫做超对称。
When we discovered antimatter back in 1932, we introduced antimatter for every single particle, and we doubled the number of particles in the universe.
在1930年代，我们发现了一些粒子，叫做反粒子。那实际上，我们把粒子的总数变成两倍了。
In a similar way, there is an idea called supersymmetry that says for every matter particle we have seen so far, there is a partner particle.That has no spin.
这样的想法就这样的想法套用在这现在的话，就是说我们可以引入这个所谓的超对称呢，使得每一个粒子呢都有它的一个的伙伴呢，它是没有自旋的，没有脸的。
These new particles are not part of the standard model.
这些粒子并不是这个基本所谓的标准模型的一部分。
But if the idea of supersymmetry is correct.That will be part of a supersymmetric standard model.
如果这个超对称理论是对的话，他们会是超对称超对称底下的标准模型的一部分。
If that is the case, Higgs boson is one out of many, many spinless particles.
如果这个是真的话，那这个希格斯波粒子只不过是很多很多不带自旋的粒子之中的其中一份子。
Then it may not be too surprising.That out of many spinless particles, just one of them acquired a property to freeze into the universe.
若是这种情形的话，这一点也不奇怪。在很多很多不带自旋的粒子里面，有一个粒子呢，使得宇宙被冻结了。
That is an example of a model that has siblings and relatives of the Higgs boson.
这就是一个例子呢，使得这个希格波是有很多的兄弟姐妹以及亲戚。
And by measuring the properties of Higgs boson very precisely, we hope to see that there is actually a sibling, brothers or sisters of the Higgs boson.
借由非常仔细研究希格斯波粒子的一些特性呢，也许我们可以借此发现它有没有兄弟姐妹。
Did I answer your question?
回答你的问题了吗？看起来是的。Any other questions or
Sorry. Doctor, you are currently involved in two different fields, particle physics and also astronomy. So I would like to ask, how do these two fields complement each other?
问题是这样子的，是春山教授，你同时在两个不同的领域里面研究工作，包括粒子以及天文这样东西，你是怎么样子把他们如何整理你的工作啊，怎么就处理的？
They are really two different type machines, as I said at the very beginning.
那么就像是两个不一样的时光机器，就像我一开始说的一样。
And we really need both to understand the history and the future of the universe.
就需要两个都需要，才能让我们了解整个宇宙的历史。
For example, if you are trying to understand relatively recent universe, telescopes are the way to go.
如果你想要了解比较接近、比较现代一点的宇宙呢？望远镜就是你需要的工具。
But if you'd like to understand the very beginning of the universe, accelerators are the way to go.
如果你真的要了解非常非常早期的宇宙，你就需要这个加速器了。
And only after putting information from both directions together, you understand the entire history of the universe.
只有当你把这个这两样工具全部凑齐，资讯凑齐之后，你才能真正了解整个宇宙的历史。
So that we can understand where we came from.
就能了解我们从哪里从何而来的这个基本问题。Yeah. Okay.
Are you happy?
Yeah.
Good.
More questions, 更多的问题。
那请教一下这个，Higgs 粒子啊，我们说它是每一个粒子是相同还是相似？因为我们知道，我们没有办法了解说这个一个粒子，现在基本粒子到底是每一个都是相同的还是相似。相似就是说它有共同的性质让我们了解的，那相同就是两个完全一样，它能量完全一样，所有的都是一样的。那这个问题一直困扰，请来解释一下好吧。
Okay, let me try to translate this a bit tricky. Idea is like this. Well, I want to ask that there's a Higgs particle. There are many Higgs particles, but those particles are just similar to each other in terms of properties or other things, or they are exactly the same. To translate, maybe Jojo has a way to make
it. Add a little bit. So you, not just identical, but there's a question whether they are all the same energy.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, for example, in the model for supersymmetry I mentioned, there are at least 5 Higgs bosons.
在超对称里面至少有五个希格斯破式子。
And some of them even have an electric charge.
他们在这些希格斯破式子中，甚至他们有些还有带电荷。
And most likely they have different masses too.
最有可能是他们甚至有大概会有更不一样的质量。
So once you do find siblings of the Higgs boson, measuring their properties and their masses will tell you.What is the right theory behind them?
当你研究更多的这些希格斯波士的兄弟姐妹之后，也许你有办法推敲整个关于这个希格斯波士的兄弟姐妹们的一些特性。
And that is exactly the kind of study we would like to do by combining the LHC and IOC in the future.
这就是我们真正在我们接下来要做的，就是组合 LHC 以及 IOC 所来的实验的结果呢。我们真的要做的一件事情。
Does that answer your questions?
这有回答问题吗？
我的意思不是这样啊，我的意思不是说他的有兄弟姊妹，就是说他一个啊，他是一个，他不是不管他的兄弟姊妹。如果说我们说其中一个啊，兄弟姊妹其中一个，然后我们说他这一类的 Higgs 粒子。我们说这一类的所有的这一类的是相同啊，是 identity 还是 similar 啊？那我们说 identity 怎么证明是吧？我的意思是这样，我并不是说它的 relatives 啊，我就是说它其中之一。我们说这是它的 relative 其中之一种，这一种到底是所有都是一样，还是说是相似而已？
Okay, let me translate into the direction is that the many Higgs particles, and those particles, are they really identical, exactly the same, or they are just similar in some sense? I think the same means totally the same, even the energy.
They are similar, but not identical. For example, in the model with 5 Higgs bosons, they have different masses, some of them have charges, but they are all faceless, so that in that sense they are similar.
I think it's, suppose it's only one Higgs particle,
but if you
produce many of them, certainly they have different energy, but are they all the same? It's an identical particle versus distinguishable similarity. Like you and Jack are both human, but you can be distinguished, they're not identical.
Well,
that's the first part. Okay. It's not about sibling.
Yeah. the Christians just like, you make a more better translation than me. Yeah. Others are same party. Yeah.
They are indistinguishable. And that's actually not special about the Higgs boson. All the electrons in your body are also indistinguishable. If you interchange them, you're still you. Nothing changes.
所有的希格斯波子都是一样的，都是完全相同的。那就像你身世上不是只有希格斯波子，包括你身体里面所有的电子也都是一样的。那愿意交换两个电子，并不会让你变成另外一个人，可以这么说，这样可以吗？
对，所以一样啊，在哲学上讲一样 ，identity 是一个很难证明的。因为这是一个数学，如果一等于一啊，这个可以啊。但是你这是一个抽象的，如果从物理的角度说，这两个完全一样，这个证明是非常困难的。只能说它的性质 quality 是一样的，但是你证明说它所有都是一样，它的能量是一亿分之一都是一样的，那这个能证明吗？还是只是说我们现在就当作它是一样的，这两个是不一样。
Okay, the question is that how can you prove those particles are identical particles?
That's very hard to prove, and we just found couple so far. It's very difficult to say they're all identical yet. So that's something we still have to study too.
这种是一个非常困难的问题，我们的确还需要做更多的研究才能。我们只发现一些是真的是一模一样的。
And because this is such a good question, I'd like to move on. If you still would like to ask, you can come up here later.
Because this question is really interesting, so if you really want to know, we can ask you privately, so we can give you more opportunities.
And I'd like to encourage, especially high school students in the audience, to ask some questions.
Especially those 高中生以及大家希望能够多问点问题，年轻人。
I would like to know more about dark energy and how can we answer the question you just listed from dark matter and dark energy.
我想要知道关于暗能量的更多的资讯。
Dark matter and dark energy are two different things.
暗物质跟暗能量是两个不一样的东西。
But we don't understand either of them.
但是我们两个都搞不清楚。
And they are 95% of the universe.
他们占了宇宙的95%的部分。
There's one big difference between them.
他们有一点点不太一样。
If the universe is a box, if you make it twice as big, the volume becomes 8 times bigger.
如果宇宙是一个盒子，然后你把它弄了两倍大，那
If you make the universe twice as big.Volume is 8 times bigger.
Yeah, 如果宇宙是一个盒子，你把它的这个长度拉成两倍，它的体积是变成了八倍。
Then the dark matter inside would thin out by 8 times.
那在这个暗能量会变得比较稀薄，变成八倍稀薄。
That's the same behavior as any ordinary matter like atoms.
这个暗物质就跟这样的反应呢，就跟任何的一般的东西是一样，你把空间膨胀八倍的时候，你也变得稀薄八倍。
That's why dark matter is matter, because it behaves the same way as ordinary matter, even though we don't know what it is.
这就是为什么暗物质被称作物质呢？实际上跟一般的物质在这样的反应上是类似的。
But dark energy is different.
但是暗能量是不同的。
If you make the box twice as big, the volume becomes 8 times bigger. Dark energy doesn't thin out.It looks like becomes 8 times bigger.
对于暗能量而言，如果你把这个宇宙膨胀八倍呢，它并不会变得比较稀薄，就像是变得八倍一样多。
Really bizarre.
非常的诡异吧。
And we are trying to understand the nature of dark energy by using telescope like Sumir Project I mentioned.
我们尝试使用望远镜来了解这个暗能量的一些资讯，取得暗能量的资讯，像是这个 Sumiri 这样的一个望远镜。
On the other hand, understanding what dark matter is another objective of LHC and ILC experiments.
另外 另外说来，这个了解什么到底什么是暗物质呢，也是LGC 跟 IOC 的一个主要的研究主题。
Because dark matter must have been made in the Big Bang. If you put enough energy, you may be able to make dark matter in the laboratory.
因为暗物质在宇宙大爆炸诞生之初一定被产生，所以如果我们在实验里面你注入过多的能量，你也可以产生出它来。
This is how we hope to make progress.
这就是我们的期望，那么来研究这个东西的方式。
But there's no guarantee that we will succeed until you try it.
当然我们没有办法保证你 会做出什么东西来，所以要直到你去尝试它。
So please join us.
加入我们就是对了。还有更多的问题吗？ Yeah. Yeah. Go ahead. Yeah.
我是你
好你好。
我想问那个刚才说每秒钟有很多的微中子诶，穿过我们的身体，那代表它还会继续行动。那它会去哪里？就是该怎么讲？它会到某个地方去停下，或者是它就会一直走，或者是会消失之类的吗？
好，let me translate this question. She want to ask about we just mentioned about neutrinos, right, produced by the sun and passing through us, our body. The question that was just like, well, neutrinos still go trapped and will it stop at some point or hit something at the end or anything?
It sometimes hits something and ends there, but doesn't disappear. It turns into something different.
如果东西撞到一个东西它没有消失的话，它只变成另外一样不同的东西。
When neutrino from the sun hits something, it may turn into an electron.
如果这个微中子从太阳来，它不小心打到什么东西，它可能可以变成电子。
And when electron hits something, sometimes it turns into neutrino too.
那当然，这个电子不小心撞到了什么东西，它也可以产生微中子。
That's the really strange thing about the weak force.
这就是我们研究所发现所谓的弱作用力的方式。
It sometimes turns one type of particle to some other type of particle.
有时候它把一种形式粒子转换成另外一种形式的粒子。
But it doesn't happen very often at all.
当它的产生的几率相当低了。
If you want to make sure that the neutrinos coming from the sun would turn into electrons for sure, you have to stack up.The bulk of lead all the way for 3 light years.
如果你要确定这个太阳来的微中子决定可以变成电子的话，你需要三光年的 3 light years， 三光年的这个的一个材料，要帮它转换。
So that's how shy neutrinos are.
这就是如让我们知道这个微中子有多么的害羞。这样回答的问题吗？
谢谢。
Thank you.
You're welcome. I understand 哲学。Good.
That's one. Yeah.
What data indicates that the Higgs boson may decay into dark particles?
Could you repeat? 你可以再讲一次吗？抱歉。
What kind of data indicates that the Higgs boson may decay into dark particles?
哪样的实验数据可以说明这个希格斯玻色子可以产生暗物质
？That is a very good question.
这是一个非常好的问题。
So how can you tell something disappeared?
你要怎么说什么东西消失了
？Because dark matter particle is not something you can see.
因为暗物质是有些都是四种你没有办法看到的东西。
So.The way you can tell something disappeared is by doing a subtraction.
你能够发现什么东西消失，你就做个减法吧。
You collect everything you can see.
你收集所有你看得到的东西。
Make sure you're not missing anything.
然后非常的小心，确定你没有失掉任何的东西。
And if you do a head-on collision, then everything should come out balanced, above and below, left and right.
如果你做一个这样子的对撞的话，所有的能量、所有的东西分布呢，必须是基本上是对称的，上跟下对称，左跟右对称。
But if you see an imbalance, let's say particles are coming out only above.
如果你看到一些不平衡的现象，比如说粒子只出现在正往上的方向。
Then you can be sure something invisible went downwards.
那你就可以认定说有一些看不到的东西往下面产生。
So by collecting everything you can see by subtraction, you can tell how many invisible things are made.
对，方法就是你收集所有你看得到的东西，然后减掉然后看他们有没有不平衡的地方，得到你可以知道说哪些东西是你看不到的。
That's how you want to discover that Higgs boson may have decayed into something invisible.
这就是如果就是一个方法用来侦测如果希格斯玻色子衰变成你看不到的东西的时候的一个方式。
So elementary school math is very important.
所以这个小学史是非常重要，小学史也非常重要，数学小学数学。Okay, that's just go ahead. Yeah.
我可以问一下吗？就是有关刚刚他谈到，就是他无脸的部分是有可能会是维度上的问题。那我想要请问，就是他认为的维度上问题是我们现在预有的维度，还是就是我们会先假设宇宙是某个维度，还是从不同理论看那个维度，还是看不到脸，就是无所谓的无脸。因为不是类似像弦理论会有类似超比较高维的四五或是到九或十二的那种维度的宇宙，那样还去看它，那这样去看就有关粒子的那些性质，它会是对的或是错的吗？
可能要请你再稍微的讲，你是说问是说
就是他说他的无脸的特质，
无脸的特质
可能的其中一个原因是因为。
它
的维度比我们所处的宇宙的维度高，
对，有可能是这意思。这样，
目前可是我的问题是，那我们是知道我们目前宇宙的维度吗？
Okay.
还是我们不知道，然后去这样去假设呢？
Okay, so the question is like this: we just discussed probably a faceless actually can be maybe a kind of a the faceless properties actually maybe still have face but in the extra dimension, but the But the question is that this is based on we know how many dimensions we have or actually not.
Okay, we actually don't know how many dimensions there are in our universe.
事实上我们不知道我们的宇宙有多少的维度。
Right now, three dimensions of space is all we can see.
就现在为止三个维度是我们可以看到的。
But we are trying to look for these extra dimensions again using LHC and IOC.
当然，我们也同时在找超过三个维度的空间，使用 IOC 跟 LHC 的实验。
Sometimes, if you smash particles against each other, you may lose some particle into extra dimensions.
有时候你把两个粒子对撞呢，也许有些粒子呢，经由高维度空间而遗失掉。
Then again, using subtraction.You may be able to tell something went away from our three dimensions of space.
一样，你做个减法，在有时候你可以发现一些粒子呢，也许它走去了另外一个时空当中。
And if you have enough of that kind of data, you can tell how many dimensions they are, what kind of shape they have.
如果你有过多实验数据，你也许可以借由推算出我们到底有多少的空间的维度，然后有什么样的形状分布。
Now you should also join this game too.
你应该加入大家来研究这个主题才对，可以吗 ？That's another lady.
Okay. From your lecture, you said that the Higgs get frozen in the very early universe. But there is not enough time for the Higgs to agree to freeze in a single direction.So, would this affect the properties of particles passing through the frozen Higgs?
Translate, 是说，如果希格粒子在宇宙诞生之初是冷冻状态下，但它没有办法冷冻在同一个方向，那这样会影响这些粒子穿透 其他粒子穿透性的是粒子的这个世界呢，有什么样会造成什么样的影响？Just like the Higgs particle was frozen at the beginning of the universe, but not really frozen in the same direction. And what's the effect of this kind of things to the properties of other particles? Am I right?
Yeah. It's actually important that Higgs boson is faceless.
很重要就是这个希格斯粒子是没有脸的。
If the Higgs boson has face and spinning in one direction.The whole universe ends up having one particular direction.
如果粒子是一个是粒子是有脸的，那在振动的时候，整个宇宙就是有个方向性的。
But as far as we can tell, every direction of the universe looks the same.
到目前为止，我们认为我们可以看得出来，整个宇宙所有的方向基本上是一样的。
To make sure of that, Higgs boson that freezes into the universe should not have a face.
为了要达成这个东西，如果希格斯粒子就是让宇宙冷冻的一个源头的话，它不应该有脸。
And our friends on CMS seem to have confirmed that based on the data.
那我们的 CMS 的朋友们呢，就是证明的这件事情使用的实验数据。
Does that answer your question?
现在回答你的问题吗
？Okay.
Yeah. Okay. 更多的问题。
Sorry, can I add to that? To that question, actually, it's about the symmetry breaking of the Higgs. You probably have different directions in the gauge field. So would that affect the gauge properties of particles?
在对称性破缺的时候，这个
Maybe I can talk to.
Yeah, it's a little bit tricky to translate into proper Chinese. To be honest,
it's clearly an expert question, so this violates the rule of a public lecture.
Yeah. Okay. That's a student.
我想问一下就是说，我们不是说那个暗物质暗能量是看不见的，那你说暗物质暗能量占宇宙中95%，那我们要怎么知道这95%是怎么来的？
This question is about the dark energy and dark matter. We cannot see it. And you say the planet is like 95% of the universe. How do we know?
That's a very good question too.
这是个很好的问题。
Dark matter.Is matter, so they actually attract each other by gravity.
暗物质它是物质，所以它其实会互相吸引，借由重力的作用。
For example, inside our own galaxy, our solar system is not at the center, but about 280,000 light years away from the center.
就像你知道，我们的太阳系呢，其实并不在宇宙中心，而是偏离银河的中心有一定的距离。
So it's actually moving around the center of the galaxy at an incredible speed of 220 kilometers per second.
它其实是用一个非常高的速度绕着这个银河中心在转 200 kilometers. Sorry, I cannot translate the number. Yeah. Okay. 抱歉，它的速度非常的高，绕着银河中心在转。
So the only reason we can stay inside the galaxy, even though we're moving so fast.Is because our galaxy has a lot of dark matter inside, and it's pulling us.
之所以我们可以这样子用非常高的速度绕银河在中心在转，是因为有非常多的暗物质在中间吸引着我们。
So studying the motion of stars and galaxies, you can tell how much dark matter there should be to pull these objects and keep them together.
研究这个星系以及星球之间的运动呢，你可以推算出有多少的暗物质呢，必须要存在它来使得造成这样的一个运动的现象。
So that's how we have learned about 25% of the universe is dark matter.
这就是我们为什么知道整个宇宙中有25%呢，其实是暗物质。
On the other hand, people have tried to understand how universe has been expanding from the beginning.
换句话说，另外来说，这个我们也在研究这个宇宙是怎么样的扩张。
Einstein told us that expansion of universe is like holding a ball in your hand and throw it upwards.
如果爱因斯坦说，就像宇宙的扩张就像是握的一个球，然后只是往上丢。
Initial thrust is the Big Bang。
往上冲的刚开始往上冲的力量呢，就是大爆炸。
The way the ball keeps going up is like the expansion of the universe。
当这个球往上走，就像是宇宙的扩张。
And because the gravity only pulls, the ball should get slower and slower。
因为重力会吸引它，使这个宇宙呢会它会越扩张越来越慢。
But when people measured it, the ball was getting slowly at the beginning, but at some point started to kick up speed.
对我们来测量来说，这个球呢一开始是慢慢的往上飞，但是突然一见它速度就上升了。
So universe started to accelerate recently.
我发现宇宙最近才开始加速。
As recently as 7 billion years ago.
最近七十亿年前 ，Yeah.
So something is pushing and pulling.
所以有些东西是在推而不是拉。
So how much universe is getting faster tells you how much push there is, and that told us the dark energy is about 70% of the universe.
计算它这东西怎么样的被加速呢，就可以推算出我们有宇宙有70%呢，其实大这所谓暗能量所造成的。
And we got to know these numbers only in 2003, so this is a very new big revolution.
我们只有在2003年的时候才开始知道这些数字，所以这是一个非常非常重要的一个进展，可以吗？
I would like to ask, because we all know that the Higgs boson is the last puzzle in standard model, and it seems that there's just few questions we can find out to do the research in particle physics. For example, like why the neutrino mass is so small. So my question is, how do you think the future of particle physics?
Let me translate. 那我翻译就是，这问题就是这样说，在因为希格斯玻色子听起来就像是最后几个问题之一。那之后我们问题可能只剩下像是为什么微中子质量是这么小等等等。那如果做一个研究者，你觉得我们应该要做什么东西，以及将来的这个整个领域的发展
？Did you come from funding agency?
你是从这个比如说国高会来的吗？
Well, there's still many things we'd like to understand. Neutrino mass, you said, is one very important subject indeed.
还有很多东西其实我们需要知道。当然，这个微中子量就像你提到一样，是一个非常重要的主题。
And as I tried to emphasize in my talk today, there are still so many things we don't understand about the Higgs boson either.
就像我今天演讲所提到的东西，我们还有很多东西其实不清楚，包括希格斯玻色子本身的一个特性。
And if there really are siblings and relatives of the Higgs boson, we would like to discover them.
如果它真的有它的兄弟姐妹或它亲戚，我们当然要想要发现它。
And some of them may be the dark matter particle.
那么有些很可能就是暗物质。
So these questions we think are coupled.
这些问题其实都耦合在一起。
Did I answer your question?
这样回答你的问题吗？
Two last questions, 最后两个问题。刚刚原来后面好像更早有一位
台风我记不得方向了，也真的后面有点对，好吧，对要什么？要来一个？
哇，好吧，你们现在选的都给我好了，不过我们很快就要欣赏了。
OK， 好，那就我们现在刚举手三位就把问完吧，这样可以吗？
五位，
有五位吗？
我想请问一下，就刚刚提到 LHC 的实验，那个 Higgs boson 很快就 decay 掉了，那是它是很难存在吗？然后是它是现在还有吗？还是它只有在宇宙的早期有存在？然后为什么我们说 Higgs boson 冷冻了整个这个宇宙？这个是怎么来的？谢谢。
Okay, let me translate. The question is like this. when we discuss the LGC, there's a Higgs boson with decay fast, right? So is that Higgs boson just dead? And we still have that? This is question one. Question two is that the so why actually Higgs particle must take the responsibility of frozen the universe?
The first question, the Higgs boson decays so quickly if you take it out.
事实上是这样，如果你把这个希格斯玻色中只把它拿出来的话，它很快就会衰变掉。
But as long as it's frozen in space, it's stable.
如果它还在于这空间里面冷冻的状态下，它是一个稳定的状态。
That's what's happening in your body too.
这在你的身体里面也一样会发生。
If you take a neutron out of your body, out of the nucleus, it decays in 15 minutes.
Yeah, 如果你拿把一个中子从你身上拿出来的话，它很快就15分钟之内就衰变掉了。
But as long as it stays inside the nucleus, it's stable.
当这个中子还待在你身体里面的时候呢，在原子核里面的时候，它还是一个稳定的粒子。
So that is actually a consequence of energy conservation.
事实上，这就是某种程度的能量守恒的表现。
So Higgs boson is stable as long as it's frozen in, but once you take it out, it has enough energy to decay into other particles.
所以希格斯玻色子来说，如果它还是冷冻在那边的时候，它是安定的。但你把它拿出来，它就有足够多的能量呢，使它可以衰变成其他东西。
Now I don't remember what the second question was.
The second question was LGC.
Was it?
抱歉，可以再说一次第二个问题吗？
就是为什么说希格斯粒子冷冻了这个宇宙
？Okay, why Higgs particle take the responsibility of frozen the universe? They take the role. Yeah.
Actually, that's exactly the kind of things we are trying to understand.
这其实就是我们现在在想要了解的一件事情：为什么希格斯玻色子冷冻了这个宇宙
？Why is this particle so special? Why did it freeze in?And we don't understand that.
为什么这粒子是这么的特别？它为什么冷冻了宇宙？这是我们想要知道的。
就是我们是观察到什么才说这句话吗？
Is that we see any evidence and we say something like this? Because we see something and we see some evidence and we claim this kind of statement?
For example, in theories that has siblings of Higgs boson, why did only the Higgs boson freeze in, but not the other siblings also freeze into the universe?
在理论里面有些它可以存在一些它的兄弟姐妹。那它可以说明这些这为什么这个希格斯玻色子可以冷冻这个宇宙
？That's a very important question because if some other particles also freeze into the universe.Even electromagnetism may become short-range, then the light would not travel very far.
在某些特殊的情况下，如果其他粒子也可以让冷冻这个宇宙的话，也许光比如说电磁作用力就没有办法形成一个长作用力，也许光就没办法穿的走那么远。
Then we cannot see each other.
那我就看不到你了。
And the reason why it happened that way, we don't know yet.
那为什么会发生这样的现象？答案是我们不知道。
So please study that with us.
请加入我们一起研究哈。So, yeah, probably the last one.
Thank you. According to my understanding, the Higgs boson or the Higgs system cooled down the universe after the Big Bang, transformed the energy to the mass. So after the universe cooled down, does this system still working?Just like how it worked at the beginning of the Big Bang. And we said that the Higgs bosons transformed to something else, like dark energy. So are there any new Higgs bosons born? And how do they, if it is true, how do they born? Thank you.
Okay, this sounds like two questions. 在这个希格斯玻色子在宇宙诞生之初，这希格斯玻色子是冷冻了宇宙，然后造成了把能量换成了质量。那这样的机制是不是在现在还是一样的在进行中？ 那第二个问题是问的是说，不是 repeat your second question, sorry.
对，我是说，就是第二个问题是，就是我们说这个希格斯波射子，它会转换成其他东西，像是暗物质之类的。那如果他们转换掉成其他东西的话，那是否会有新的希格斯波射子诞生？那他们通过什么样的方式诞生
？Okay, second question was actually you already said in English, right? So hope you remember. The second question is this boson can produce this dark energy, dark matter, and is that any new Higgs boson can be produced out of this kind of mechanism?
Okay, so for the first question, if the Higgs boson has frozen the universe very early on, is it still doing the same job it was doing early on?
Yeah.
And to the extent we can tell, it is. But it may have changed over time.
可能是这样，但它也许对随时间它是不断在改变的。
So just like water freezing into ice, it can change over time.
就跟水冻结成冰，它可以随时间改变一样。
So how exactly is individual Higgs boson freezing? Is another thing we are trying to understand.
关于希格斯波的怎么样子这样随时间改变的冷冻这个宇宙呢，是我们正在研究的主题之一。
So we don't quite know that yet, but once it has frozen in, the rest doesn't seem to have changed very much.
我们还在研究，不过自当它冷冻了之后呢，这东西看起来就不太会变化了。
If it's still changing, that might be a problem for us.
如果还在改变的话，就它可能是一个大问题啊。
Some people are talking about Higgs boson all of a sudden changed another form and our universe is doomed.
如果这个希格斯波射子突然变成其他的形式的话，我们就像下地狱了一样。
But according to our latest calculations, it may take billion times billion times billion times billion times the age of the universe, so I wouldn't worry about it.
根据一些计算呢，这样的事情要发生是花无法计数的一个巨大的年呢，才会发生。那我根本不担心这件事情。
On the second question, can Higgs boson turn into other types of Higgs boson?
Well, it's slightly different. It's Higgs boson can turn into dark matter. And they said, can we produce new Higgs boson out of that or something?
I see. So if Higgs boson can turn into dark matter, for example, can dark matter turn into Higgs boson? Is that the kind of question you're asking?
Yes.
就是说，问题是这样：如果这希格斯波射子可以变成暗物质、暗能量，是不是可以再变成希格斯波射子
？In principle, yes.
答案就是是的。
But most likely, when Higgs boson turns into dark matter comes out fast and fly apart quickly.
但很多时候，这个希格斯波射子就变成了这个暗物质之后呢，它很快的就飞走了。
To reverse the process.You need to bring in two dark matter particles very quickly to produce the Higgs boson.
对，你要反过来这样的一个反应话，你要拿了两颗暗物质，很快的速度把它压过来。
That may have been happening when the universe is very hot.
这可能在宇宙很热的时候，很可能会发生。
But in the cold universe today, even dark matter particles are moving fairly slowly.
在这么的宇宙冷却的今天，这些暗物质移动的速度相当缓慢。
So even though it's possible in principle, it's very unlikely.
即使这样的反应呢是有可能发生的，但是机会不太大。
Does that answer your question?
回答问题吗
？Yes, thank you.
Okay.
我想我们还是在这里结束，因为原来讲说3:30到5:30，不过有兴趣的同学或那个朋友们可以先到前面来，欣赏的时间我再去了解。I think since we advertised that this will be from 3:30 to 5:30, I think we should close now, allow people to leave. Those who still have questions, you can come forward and we'll talk about how to clean this room later.
Do I get extra pay for that?
Well, we'll book this room to you.